Imagine when put into action offends mediocrity. Mediocrity, get ready to be offended. If some people are offended because we're passionate about the gospel, that's okay. Mediocrity hates passion. So if you're offending mediocrity, you're in a good camp.
Hopeless generation, and people need the God of hope more than ever. And here's really what my message is summed up in, Romans 15, 13, which says, now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. And how you perceive God dictates how you receive from God. And if you perceive God as an angry landlord who's ticked off at the tenants of planet Earth because we messed up this rock and played our music too loud, we're gonna be really depressed.
I'm Ben Courson, the host of Hope Generation, and you just took in a quick clip of our last episode. We are the ones who carry buckets of water for those still consumed by the fire. We are the taste tests of heaven.
Hope is not something that we just have a little bit of, but we don't want to be too crazy about it. No, we're like rejoicing in hope. It is our stoke. We're so pumped about it. We just have this word like Jeremiah burning in our bones like a fire and we can't keep it shut in. We rejoice in hope. Now, let me read this text from another version. This is kind of to amplify and clarify it. Listen to this. Paul says there's more to come. Romans 5, we continue to shout our praise even when we're hemmed in with troubles because we know how troubles can develop passionate patience in us and how that patience in turn forges the tempered steel of virtue, keeping us alert for whatever God will do next in alert expectancy such as this. We're never left feeling shortchanged. Quite the contrary, we can't round up enough containers to hold everything God generously pours into our lives through the Holy Ghost. Okay, I'm excited about this, even if no one else is. Okay, listen to this. Notice how in verse 2, he says, we have access to God. The first thing you have to understand about the God of hope is that he is accessible. Some people see God as like the divine spark within every living being or an implacable, vengeful soldier who wants to lop off people's heads or the force that really is indifferent to the plight of mankind or the divine clockmaster who winds up the universe and lets it go and just steps back from all of humanity. Some have seen God as a complete stranger, the utterly untouchable. The author H.G. Wells, who wrote these amazing books called Time Machine and War of the Worlds, he actually writes in one of his books about a man who was like tensed and strained and in pressure because he was in serious danger of a complete nervous and mental breakdown. And he goes to the doctor and the doctor says to the man, the only way you can be saved is to find the peace that fellowship with God can bring. He said, wait, what, fellowship with God? To think of that up there having fellowship with me? I would as soon think of cooling my throat with the Milky Way or shaking hands with the stars. He says, okay, you're telling me that my mental breakdown will be stayed by having a relationship with that up there? You might as well tell me to cool my throat with the Milky Way or shake hands with the stars. To him, God was totally untouchable. But Paul says, okay, what you gotta get is we have access to God by faith. The same God who made In-N-Out, which tastes like hope, feels. He says, man, that drive-thru might be long, but there's never a waiting line when you come to talk to me. I'm here, you have access, come to the drive-thru and I'll give you some encouragement, nourishment, and there's no wait. I am listening the minute you, in fact, before There is even a word on your tongue, Psalm 139, I know it altogether, says God. So you got to know that we have hope because we have access to God by faith. Notice what he goes on to say. Verse 3, he says, we know that trouble produces patience. Now, that word trouble or tribulation or trial, that word in the Greek language is the word thlipsis. It just sounds fun to phonetically to say. Everybody say thlipsis. Like with T-H-L-I-P-S-I-S. Thlipsis. Everybody say thlipsis. Thlipsis was a form of capital punishment when you were going to kill somebody. In ancient times, sometimes you would lay a weight on their chest until it crushed them, till they died. That's what thlipsis was. It literally means pressure. Everybody please say pressure. Every great football player, every great athlete, every great quarterback, every great tennis player knows this little secret, that pressure is a privilege. Pressure is a privilege. It's when the pressure's on that the best stuff can happen. Pressure, that's what thlipsis means. Pressure. It's when all kinds of things might press in around Christians, want and straitened circumstances, sorrow, persecution, unpopularity, loneliness. All that pressure, Paul says, produces in us patience. I love this. That word for patience or perseverance or endurance, depending on your translation, in the Greek language is the word, one of the great classical words in Greek literature. You got to know this word. It is hupomone. Would everybody say hupo? Moni. You say hippo money? What are you even talking about? Hupo moni literally can be translated triumphant fortitude. Triumphant fortitude. Everyone say triumphant fortitude. So the pressure that you're going through right now, the pressure that you go through in life produces in you triumphant fortitude, Paul says. Triumphant fortitude. I love this. Here's a couple examples. The spirit which can overcome the world, it means the spirit which does not passively endure, but which actively overcomes the trials and tribulations of life. Here's what hupomone is. When Beethoven was threatened with deafness, the most terrible of troubles for a musician, how much would that stink if you're a musician and you go deaf? There's very few things that could be worse for a musician. Do you know what Beethoven did when he went deaf? He said, I will take life by the throat. So they're saying, oh, poor me. I'm like the greatest musician ever and I go deaf so I can't even hear my own music. He says, I'm gonna take life by the throat. That, my friends, is hupomone. When Sir Walter Scott, responsible for the historical novel in Scotland, when he was involved in ruin because of bankruptcy, his publishers went bankrupt. And so that's hard for an author hundreds of years ago. If your publishers go bankrupt, how are you gonna produce your works with them anymore? He said, no man will say to me, poor fellow. He said, my own right hand will pay the debt. As Kipling would say, it's when you can watch the things you gave your life to broken and stoop and build them up with worn out tools. Oh, that's hupomone right there. I love this one. Someone once said to a gallant soul who was undergoing a great sorrow, sorrow fairly colors life, doesn't it? He replied, yes, sorrow does color life, and I propose to choose the color. That is hupomone. When Henley was lying in Edinburgh infirmary, his leg got amputated, and his other leg was about to get amputated. That's when he wrote a poem called Invictus. He wrote, out of the night that covers me, black as the pit from pole to pole. Listen, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul, but I want to change that poem today to this. Out of the night that covers me, black as the pit from pole to pole, I thank the God of hupomone for my unconquerable soul. Would somebody say amen? Amen. That's what thlipsis does to us. It produces in us hupomone. Then he says, look at the next phrase. Hupomone produces character or experience. That word in Greek is dokimi. Would everybody say dokimi? Dokimi, as we exposit this text, is used of a metal which has been passed through the fire so that everything that has been base is purged out of it. It is the word used of coinage. It's the same word we use for sterling. When you say something is sterling, that's the word that Paul uses. When affliction is met with fortitude, out of the battle, a man or a woman emerges stronger and purer and better and nearer to God than ever before. And then he says, thlipsis produces hupomone, which produces dokimi, which then produces hope. And a hope maketh not ashamed by the love of God spread in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Hope is not hype. It's based on the facts that God has never failed anyone, and he ain't gonna start with me. This hope is not airy-fairy, loosey-goosey. Did you know the word hope in Hebrew? When you see the word hope, like the eye of the Lord is upon them, that hope in his mercy, the psalmist said, the word hope in Hebrew literally means knitted. When you see the word hope in the Old Testament in Hebrew, it literally means knitted. It's not loosey-goosey, it's watertight. It's knitted to ultimate reality. Our Lord is the God of hope. It drives me crazy. Some people say, are you a glass half empty or a glass half full kind of Christian? Like, well, scientifically, I'm a glass totally full kind of Christian. Because half the glass, scientifically, is filled with hydrogen and oxygen, and the other half of the glass is filled with nitrogen and oxygen. So I don't say my glass is half empty or half full. I prescribe to what David said, my cup runneth over. Come on. That's what we say. We have a totally different mindset from the world. These are not our two options. Is it gonna be fish, the Israelites asked, or is it gonna be cattle? And the Lord says, I'm gonna send fowls. And they all hit a homer. It actually says that in the Old Testament. Anyways. Hope is not hype. It's based on the facts. My cup runs over. Oh, but Ben, God doesn't meet my expectations. Of course God doesn't meet your expectations. If God always met your expectations, how would he be able to exceed them? An outlook determines outcome. And when your outlook gets bleak, try the uplook. Because if you change the way you look at things, things will change the way they look. The problem is never the problem. The problem is my perception about the problem. And my hopelessness about a problem is a bigger problem than my problem. So my praise will be a problem for my problems, because I have flipsis, which produces hupomone, which then gives dokami, which produces a knitted hope to ultimate reality, which is not hype. It's based on the fact that God's never failed anyone, and he ain't gonna start with me. That's good news. That's good news. So pressure then is a privilege. I love this. It's the storms in our life, Paul says, that produces these rainbows. I never knew this verse was in the Bible until the other day. Listen to what Ezekiel 1:28 says. Brightness everywhere. The way a rainbow springs out of the sky on a rainy day, that's what it was like. It turned out to be the glory of God. How dope is that verse? I didn't even know it was there. The way a rainbow springs out of the sky on a rainy day, that's what the glory of God is like. That's what Ezekiel said. What is glory? What's the glory of God? The word glory is Shekinah, and it's kabod in Greek and Hebrew respectively. The word can literally be translated excellence. Some people think when they flow in the spirit, everything's spontaneous and it's gonna be just messy, but actually it's the other way around. When you really walk spontaneously in the spirit, everything's done more excellently. Metaphorically, the muses start singing more vocally. But the word glory also means weight, 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 weightiness. C.S. Lewis wrote a great book, one of my favorites, called The Weight of Glory. What does it mean? The weight of God is behind you. God puts his weight behind you. God puts his weight behind you. And the glory of God is like a rainbow that springs out of a sky on a stormy day. I don't know about you, but sunset is my favorite color and rainbow is second. It's like, well, that doesn't apply to the correct rules. That's why I love being a Christian, because we don't have to apply to the correct rules. That's what happens in the storms. It produces these promises that floods will never come. Again, if you're picking up what I'm throwing down, catching what I'm pitching and mowing what I'm growing, I need to hurry up here. Listen, a lot of people think when they're going through flipsis pressure, a lot of people think, man, God gave us Jesus and the Savior, kill me. And it says he's freely gonna give me all things. But it doesn't feel like that's what the Lord's gonna do, because I'm pretty sure God is holding out on me. That's why he's allowing me to go through flipsis, because he's holding out on me. Did you know that's what the devil did in the story of Genesis? That was like the first trick. It's God is holding out on me. That's what he said to Adam and Eve, remember? He said, God, listen, God, don't miss this. God, are you paying attention? Here's the devil, who the Bible says he was craftier than every beast of the field, which means he's very good at being very bad. He's out to kill, steal, and destroy, the Bible says. This force of evil marring everything God has created or trying to. It says he's the father of lies. Lying is his native language, just as for me, American and emoji are my native languages. But lying, lying is his native language. And he says, God does not want you to eat from this tree, because if you eat from this tree, he said, you will become like God. And they ate from the tree. Why? Because they thought God was holding out on them. Little did they know, they were already like God. How so? Genesis 1 says that God created man and woman in his image. So what the enemy tries to do is convince you that everything the Father has is not yours, that you're not made in his image, that God is holding out on you. And the truth is, God's not holding out on you. He deems you so precious. He says, you're already like me. You're my children. You're made in my spitting image, and I'm redeeming you, justifying, glorifying, sanctifying you. And so often, we're walking down a street, and we see a puppy, and we're like, oh, a puppy. We see a human walking a dog, and we're like, oh, a puppy. God sees a human walking a dog, and he's like, oh, a human. This human is made in my image. He loves us. He loves us. And you know what? The God, not only of hope, Romans 15, but also Paul calls him the God of patience, the God of hupomone, is with you to give you an unconquerable soul. You're made in his image. If God gave you Jesus, he'll freely with him give you all things. The other day I got a message from somebody. I literally got this message. Hello. Would you be interested in joining the Illuminati? I literally click on my Instagram and somebody messages me this. Would you be interested in joining the Illuminati? Fame, wealth, and power belongs to us. Our monthly salary is not less than $500,000. Send me a direct message or WhatsApp right now for membership. It's free. So I read this message. I'm like, okay. The Illuminati is asking me to join them, when really it's probably just some video gamer in his garage. Fame, wealth, and power belongs to us. If you just bow down to me, the enemy says, I'll give you all the kingdoms. If you just bow down to me and leap off this pinnacle of the temple, the angels will bear you up in their wings lest you dash your foot against the stone. If you will just turn these rocks into loaves of bread, you can make some dough, you can make some bread, you can roll in the dough. And here's the enemy constantly trying to lie to us, telling us that everything we have is not found in the Father of lights, but everything we need is in selling out to the kingdom of darkness. And my heart for you is that you would understand the God of hope is with you, even when you feel like your life is a mess and other people are offering balderdash stuff that just ain't real. 2 days ago, my mom dropped by something to my house. She dropped by like a snack, just being real nice. Hadn't seen her in a while just because I'd been gone, and she like put something in my house. So nice, just gives me something. But I had to go, I had to be somewhere. So I had to like race down, after giving her a hug, I like race down the stairs, and I get in my Jeep, and I like back out my Jeep, and I just slam into something. And I look behind me, and it's her like little mini car. And she wasn't in it, fortunately, but like, I slam into her hood, and I'm like, oh my goodness. This is me. My mom gives me a snack, I give her a crushed hood. Sometimes that's how life feels. Here's God giving us encouragement, nourishment, and all we do is crush his reputation by complaining and remaining rather than praising and raising up. But there's good news. That happened 2 days ago, and now that's in the past. And you know what? There's her, right, Tambo? She's like, yes, but the dent is in the present, be that as it may. There's a reason. There's a reason. Why the rear view mirror? Speaking of cars, is smaller than the windshield. Because we were meant to look back. We were meant to look forward. Would somebody say amen? Amen. We were meant to say, God, you have a boulder tomorrow for me to venture into. So if this lipsis is crushing me, or even if I've crushed your reputation through this pressure applied, listen, this is the thing about pressure. You can't miss this. Really listen to me on this. When you're going through lipsis, listen to what Paul says. Essentially, that every mess turns into a message. And every wreck is just an opportunity for God's presence to wreck me in a good way. That's slanguage. But listen to this. Thlipsis, really hear me. I'm drawing to a close. Did you know, astrophysically, for a star to be born, one thing must happen. For a star to be born, one thing must happen. Scientists and astronomers tell us, for a star to be born, one thing must happen. A gaseous nebula must collapse. A gaseous nebula must collapse. So, for a star to be born, one thing must happen. A gaseous nebula must collapse. So, collapse. It's not your destruction. It's your birth. The thlipsis that is crushing you, collapsing you, God says, you think it's your destruction? Oh my goodness, it's your birth. The thlipsis that you're undergoing now is meant to make you a Daniel 12:3 star that's shining forth in the kingdom of heaven. So my heart for us is that we would go into the world and be taste tests for the kingdom of God. So would Z come up at this time? I need a little music because bring out the minstrel that I may prophesy, Elisha said. Would you stand with me, please? Listen. 900 times the Bible speaks about your heart. It is the sum, the seat, the center of who you are. It is the nexus of your emotional existence. 900 times the Bible speaks of your heart. And maybe your heart has been broken and collapsing under thlipsis today. Listen to this. Listen to this. Don't miss this. I need your attention. Thlipsis. Broken heart, 900 times the Bible speaks of your heart. Did you know the phrase a broken heart comes from ancient Hebrew biblical literature? The Bible invented the word broken heart, the phrase broken heart. So if anyone knows what a broken heart is like, it's the author of that book. The phrase a broken heart actually originates from ancient Hebrew biblical literature, and 900 times the Bible speaks of your heart. Now, as men and women, both made in the image of God, we process grief in different ways. Now, I'm gonna paint very stereotypically with broad strokes here, but isn't it interesting how in Genesis, when Joseph had dreams, Jacob heard his son's dreams, and listen, it says in Genesis, he thought about these things. Do you follow? It says he thought about these things. Fast forward to the New Testament. When Mary, Jesus's mother, heard about her son, Jesus, it says she kept these things in her heart. So when Jacob is hearing about his son, Joseph, it says he thought about these things when he heard the dreams. When Mary hears about Jesus, her son, it says she kept or pondered these things in her heart. Now, I'm talking very stereotypically here and just like broad strokes, but physiologically and psychologically, when we're talking about the cranial package of men and women, a lot of times men tend to think rationally with their brain and women tend to think emotionally with their heart. Which is better? They're both important. They're both in the image of God. They're both different sides to God. They're both equally good, and they can both be equally deleterious and harmful. Now, I know I'm painting with broad strokes here. Don't misunderstand me. But Jacob, he thought about these things. Mary, she pondered these things in her heart. And I know that all of us, like, we process grief in different ways. Some of us try to think our way out of depression. Some of us try to feel our way out of thlipsis. But the reality is, what we all need is the God of hupomone, who for men and women alike is going to say, I have been faithful in your past. I am going to be faith-filled in your future so you can be fulfilled today. It doesn't matter if you're male or female. It doesn't matter if you're slave or free. It doesn't matter if you're Scythian or barbarian. It doesn't matter what age you are. It doesn't matter what stage of life you're in. It doesn't matter because you are all made in the image of God, and I'm not holding out on you. And if I gave you Jesus, I will freely give you everything else. So my heart for you is that you would go your way saying, I'm gonna glory in tribulation, because tribulation produces patience, and patience produces experience, and experience produces hope, and hope never makes us ashamed because of the love of God spread abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. What Paul is saying is pain makes you stronger, tears make you braver, heartbreak makes you wiser. So thank your past for a better future. Pain is weakness leaving the body, and sweat is fat crying. And what the enemy means to crush you, the Lord says, when the enemy tries to collapse you, a star is being born. So we will glory in tribulation, and we will rejoice in hope, because the God of hope never, never, never fails.
Our goal is to create pockets of heaven on planet Earth and to create outposts for the kingdom as hope generators. So glad you tuned in, and we can't wait to see you next time. We'll see you later, Hope Generators. Words fail me when I try to articulate how grateful I am to you Hope Generators who have given financially to this show. Know that any of your donations don't go to my pocket. It goes directly into this show to continue to air the message of the God of Hope across the globe. If you would like to give, you can visit bencourson.com and donate on the internet. You can text an amount to the number you see on the screen, or you can simply mail a check to this address. Thank you so much for making Hope Gen possible.